Figma dropped a ton of new features recently, and I know there's already a ton of videos on YouTube showing you exactly how to use each one of these features, but in today's video, I thought I'd walk you through the top five that I think are most useful and practical from a web designer and developer standpoint. I've ranked all of these and included some honorable mentions, so if you're just needing to get up to speed on what's available now inside Figma, then this video's for you. Patterns aren't something I use a whole lot of, but anytime you needed to do this before, it was kind of a pain in the butt. I really like the way Figma actually introduced this into the software, so let me show you how it works. Here I have this box, which just has a gray fill, but if I click into the fill, we have this new pattern option. When I select that, I can then select the source for my pattern. So here I'll just click on select source, and then I'll choose my logo over here, and you can see now my box is being filled with the source that I chose. Over here we have the option on how we want to tile this. We can change the scale of it to make our pattern bigger or smaller, and we can even add spacing in between it. This is really great for some of those subtle background textures. If I wanted to go in here and reselect my source, I'll just click on this little circle I created, and now we can create a little background texture for something that kind of pokes out behind our images or something like that. But what's really nice about this is you can always go update the source and it will update inside your pattern. See, if I change that source circle to this red color, it updates inside my pattern. If I change the width of it to make it kind of oblong here, all of that gets updated in my pattern as well. So you have a nice single source of truth. We also got two new effects in here, both texture and noise. Texture is one I've been playing with quite a bit. If we go over here into our effects panel, I'll add a new effect and we'll change this drop down to texture. And we can see that everything gets a little wonky here. I'm gonna go ahead and increase this radius quite a bit and we'll bring down the size here. Now, if I take this button, I'm gonna copy it and paste a new copy on top where I get rid of that texture. You can see we have this cool background effect back behind our button, which adds a little bit of grainy film to it. You can even reduce the opacity here and get some pretty neat effects that I'm excited about exploring. The noise effect can be pretty useful as well. We'll go ahead and add an effect to this image. We'll add noise. We'll make that noise size quite a bit smaller since we're zoomed in nicely to the image here. We can even decrease that density a little bit. And this gives a nice grain texture to our images, which can be a pretty cool effect. It's interesting to see that both of these kind of give that grunge look, which I think is kind of coming back in web design in 2025. Brushes are one of those things that I found myself always needing to go back to Illustrator for, but now we have quite a few built right in here into Figma. If I click on this advanced stroke settings here, we can go in here to our brushes and choose from a whole set of different brushes we can use. Here we can change the direction of them and of course change the weight to however we need. These are pretty nice to have in your arsenal as it can add a bit of texture to your design. We also have the option for what Figma is calling a dynamic brush, which to me just kind of looks like a wiggly line. This could be cool if you have some kind of hand-drawn design you're going for, but I don't see too many practical examples of this dynamic brush personally. This is one that I'm not sure how we went so long without having, but now we can actually type on a path. So if I have this circle here and use my text tool and hover over it, you see we get this little path icon. Now, if I click on that, let me go ahead and bump up the font size here. Now we can type directly on the path. You can, of course, move this around however you need. And if you change the alignment options, you can choose where this little handle appears on your path. This is something that I always had to open up Illustrator for, and I'm glad that I can do it now inside of Figma. There's a few things that are worth mentioning because they're nice quality of life improvements. If we switch down here into draw mode, up here in the right-hand corner, we have this option for linear repeat. With my rectangle selected here, I'll go ahead and click on that, and we'll change this direction to vertical, and now I can change how many times I want this shape repeated, or change the gap in between each one of these. The radial repeat is nice too, because when I add that, it will repeat all of these in a nice circle, and I can go in here and change the number of repeats and the gap in between all of them, which is something that would have been a real pain in the butt to do in Figma before. Another cool idea they brought in from something you're probably familiar with inside Illustrator is the Shape Builder tool. I'm still in draw mode here, and if I go ahead and click return on my keyboard, I can use this Shape Builder tool here to go and draw through my different shapes that I want to combine together. And when I release that, now I have these two separate shapes. We have this one up here and this one over here. We have this leftover down here from where they overlapped, but this is definitely a handy tool when you're drawing out shapes or doing more illustration type work. Another nice quality of life feature is where we can change the rotate point. If I just hover outside of this, you'll see we get a little icon in the center here, and this is how we can change where this is going to rotate. If you get close to any of these corners or the center of the edges, it will kind of snap into place there. But once you pick your rotate point, now when you rotate your item, it will rotate around that point. It's definitely one of those things that when you need it, it's going to be really handy. And one of the things that I ended up really liking the most, but haven't found a good practical use case for because I'm not sure exactly how I would code this into a website, is the new progressive blur feature. If we go in here to our effects and select our background blur, we have that same background blur that we had before, which gives it that nice glass morphism effect. But here we have a new toggle where we can go into the progressive blur mode. This gives us basically a gradient of blurs. You can see we have a start point and an end point. And if I change the amount of blur in this end point, we'll just crank it way up. You can see it's really blurry at the bottom and gets less and less blurry as we get to the other end. Of course, we can change this direction and it's a really nice effect. But like I said, I'm not exactly sure how I would build this out in some kind of responsible CSS without just exporting this as an image. Anytime I'm trying to do some kind of car design where maybe I want three cards across, you either have to do math or just start stretching things out to try to get them to look right inside of your content width. However, with the new grid options inside auto layout, things became a whole lot easier. Here, I'll just draw out a new frame, turn on my auto layout, and switch it over to the new grid mode. Here I can decide how big I want my grid. Let's say I want a 3x1. Now I can just draw out my cards and paste them right into this grid and they'll automatically take in that shape. Then we can control the gap between all of them. So in here I could say maybe we want 24 pixels of gap in between each one of them. And then I can manipulate my grid however I need to. If I want to go ahead and change this to a 4-column grid, all I do is change this grid to 4 columns. Now, this grid controls are a little bit limited, especially if you're thinking about it in terms of CSS grid, but it definitely helps get things laid out a whole lot quicker instead of having to fiddle with it or bust out your calculator. Down in the video description, I'll make sure to include some links to some other videos that I watched to get inspiration for this video and just to uncover some of the other new things that I didn't cover inside of this video. But let's all just stay away from the Figma sites. Hopefully you enjoyed today's video. If you did, I would really appreciate a thumbs up. And if you want to make sure to catch the next one, hit subscribe and we'll see you then.